What's up, party people? Now, first of all, we want to make sure everybody had a happy holiday season. We had a lot of people, Jordan, hey, what's going on? Where's the rebound at? Where's the... Hey, you know, we got families too.
Yeah.
You know? So we...
Lo and behold,
so we took 2 weeks off for the holidays, but so happy to be back here. And like I said, it's a new year, so we got some huge news. We have a new partner with the Rebound.
A new partner, the Rebound, is sponsored by Audi Middleburg Heights, and with the winning combination of sales and service to get you in the right ride and keep you on the road, explore their great selection of new and certified pre-owned cars and enjoy extended service and parts hours, including Saturdays, to take care of you after your purchase. And you can visit them today at AudiMiddleburgHeights.com. That's AudiMiddleburgHeights.com. And if you're in the area of Middleburg Heights, right up, get out. It's a beautiful showroom.
Oh, check
Absolutely
it out.
Absolutely beautiful showroom. You got to get in there and check it out. And then, of course, you can visit them AudiMiddleburgHeights.com. But we are so excited about this, Emmett.
No doubt. Appreciate, you know, Audi for jumping on as we're building this. We're still, you know, still building
started
the rebound.
Just an idea.
Yes.
Look where we are now.
And here we are now. You know, we got to start off 71. Got to start with 71.
What do you mean 71?
71. Donovan Mitchell drops 71 points in a 145-134 overtime victory over the Chicago Bulls. 22-34 from the field, 7-15 from three-point land.
Real quick, by the way, 22-34 from the field. I mean, it can't be mentioned enough how crazy that is.
Yeah.
To score 71 and be that efficient is absolutely insane.
Well, he was 20-25 from the line. That helps out a lot. As well, 11 assists on top of that. And Jordan, in a game that, like, it looked like they were going to lose.
You did. It looked like it was going to be one of those points where, in the narrative, right? It looked like the narrative was going to be, whoo, that was a crazy game from Donovan Mitchell. But it didn't really matter because the Cavs didn't get the win. The most important and most impressive part about that performance is the fact that he needed to do everything he did from a 71-point standpoint for the Cavs to even have a chance to be in that game, because they were getting blown out for the most, you know, majority of that game.
Mm-hmm.
Then all of a sudden it started to get close in the fourth quarter, and then he started to get really hot, and then all of a sudden that carried into overtime. And then how about, by the way, that crazy free throw miss opportunity?
You never see that work the way it's supposed to.
Say,
it worked perfectly.
All the people out there that are like, lane violation, this shouldn't have even counted. Shut up! Shut up. It should have absolutely counted. Because if you go back, there was like three Bulls who also had their feet in the lane before he even shot it. So I don't want to hear any of that. All right? I don't want to hear it.
I'm with you. The only funny thing about that is who's the Caruso got called for two lane violations earlier in the game, like over on the three-point line. That's the only reason why I was like, well, I mean, they were calling it.
Shut up.
But in that situation, I'm glad that they didn't. It worked out. It took a miracle. But the greatest single-game scoring output in Cavaliers history now belongs to Donovan Mitchell.
Yeah, and I mean, the previous was done twice. Kyrie Irving and LeBron James both had 57. So he blew that record out of the water. But also from a statistical measure, this was a historic game. Probably the second best game from a scoring and being a responsible for scoring, you know, because obviously you go back to the 100-point game for Wilt Chamberlain, and in that game, I think he had a couple assists as well. He was responsible for 104 points that night when Wilt Chamberlain dropped 100, and that still stands as the most points everyone's ever been responsible for in a basketball game. Donovan Mitchell, not only did he have 71 points, Emmett, he had 11 assists in that game.
Wow.
He was responsible for 99 points of the Cavs' 145 scored that night. That was the second most points anyone's ever been responsible for in an NBA game. So we talk about the 71, but the 11 assists as well. Like, he was every point, basically, that the Cavs scored against the Bulls in that game was directly because of him.
It was huge, too, because they needed it, missing Darius Garland and Evan Mobley. It literally got to a point where said, you know what, get on my back. Let's do it. You know, get on my back. Let's do it. Surprisingly, this is something that nobody talked about that game. I understand why, because Donovan has 71. Kevin Love had 17 boards.
17 boards.
12 and 17. He had a hell of a double-double there. Jared Allen had 21 and 8, and Jetty had 19 off the bench. So guys chipped in here and there, but it was the Donovan Mitchell show.
Donovan Mitchell played every minute in the second half of that game, and he actually spoke after the game where he, like, looked at JB and it was like, keep me in, man. Like, I understand that I have to bring it for us to have a chance in this game. And, you know, he said at the end of the game, too, like, he was joking with JB, you know, after he scored one of those threes of, like, the nine in a row that he hit. And he was sitting there, and they started laughing. He's like, well, we made it this far. Like, let's just go win the game
as well,
at this
point.
And that's exactly what he ended up doing.
Yeah, and they did it. So he's in the history books. Whenever you are in a Cavalier history book and you're not LeBron James, you did something big.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
You did something huge. So shout out to Mitch for that, because that's why they brought him here. Brought him here to be a superstar. And for me, I think he deserves some MVP mentions. You know, should he win it right now? Probably not. But is he playing like one of the best players in the NBA? Absolutely.
And I think more so than that, it's called most valuable player, right?
Mm-hmm,
I mean,
right.
You take Donovan Mitchell away from this Cavs team, who knows where they are this year, right?
Yeah, I'm interesting you brought that up.
Yeah.
Most valuable player, Mitchell, minus DG, what's their record this year?
I don't know off the top
9-0.
Without
Darius. 9-0 yeah, without Darius Garland. That's all Donovan Mitchell.
Yes, all
right.
Donovan. No, that's
all Donovan Mitchell.
But even beyond what he's doing from, like, hey, dropping 71 and 11 one night, just his mindset in that game. Like, don't take me out in the second half because we need this game, and I'm going to be the guy to do it. Like, he's been the engine that pushes this team all year. I've said it, like, you know, I'm surprised, and I'm sure you are. I knew Donovan Mitchell was good. I'll be honest, right? I wasn't crunching.
I knew
Utah
he was good,
Jazz
but I didn't know he was this good.
Right, exactly. Yeah. But I didn't know he was the type of leader that he is as well.
Yeah.
And that's what he brought. Like, that might even be more important than what he's doing from a scoring standpoint from this team. What he means to this team from a leadership standpoint. He is, without question, the leader of this team. And the Cavs are where they are because of what he brought to this locker room. And I don't think we can say that enough. If you take him away from this team, who knows where they are? DG's been hurt. Evan Mobley's been hurt.
Yeah.
Jared Allen has missed time. Who knows where the Cavs would be? Donovan Mitchell has been the one consistent thing this season for the Cavs, and they are one of the top teams in the Eastern Conference because of that.
I can tell you this. They wouldn't be a game and a half out of first place in the East.
Right.
Because that's where they're at. They're fourth right now, a game and a half behind the Celtics, Bucks, and Nets, who are both a game and a half behind Celtics. So, before the Celtics. So, 1-4 is all really tight. And then you have the Sixers, who are 2.5 games behind Boston in fifth. So, a tight Eastern Conference. So, after that game – so, listen, that game happens when sports betting goes live in Ohio. And you're looking at two guys who have thoroughly enjoyed it in the short term, for sure. So that game happens. And you go, they got another game later on this week against the Suns. Well, first let me backtrack. The game against the Bulls, it was the first time I was ever able to bet the Cavs. Woke up in the morning.
Word?
Yeah, woke up, believe it or not. Woke up in the morning. Rolled over, and I saw that the Cavs were -3 against the Bulls, right? 3-point favorites. So, I'm going to jump on that. That's a great line. I think they can win by more than 3. The day goes on, the line moves to 4.5. And I was like, I'm glad I got that 3. You know, then they report that there's no Darius Garland or Evan Mobley. And I'm like, oh, my God. I would have never took that had I known. And then I'm watching the way the game goes. And I'm all right, chalk that. Like, that money is just gone. And Donovan comes through huge. And I was able to get the win. Thank you, Donovan Mitchell. How has, in the short term, the sports gambling kind of affected the way you watch the Cavs?
Well, you know, it hasn't affected it too much, just off the standpoint that, you know, what we do here, you and I, we're huge basketball fans. We watch these games closely. We break down, you know, the game and everything that's going on. So it hasn't changed too much from that standpoint. What has changed is, like, the little things, like the over-unders, right? Total points, which I wasn't really paying attention to before. And now you're looking at it like, hey, I don't know, can they get to 215 tonight? Well, this guy's not playing, that guy's not. So you're looking more like who's not playing, who's active, that kind of thing. And I don't want to say it's changed the way that I watch the Cavs, but it's changed the way that I think about the game before the game starts, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does. It's changed the way I watch the game. So, like, before, like, if Donovan makes a cut, like, for instance, against the Suns, I was a dummy. I took Mitchell over 30.5.
I tried to tell you.
I told you
he was going to have like 17.
Didn't tell me. So, like, in past, like, I would just go, like, all right, he's not shooting it well, but all I care about is them winning.
Yeah.
Like, I don't really care.
That's
if
a good
that,
point.
So, but now I'm like, yeah, I want them to win, but come on, Donovan, what are you doing? Right? So it has changed. I always want them to win. I'll never bet against – all right, I won't say never. I probably won't ever bet against them. I don't know, you know, what may happen in the future because I like to root for – the Cavaliers. Yeah. We always say, listen, this is a fan, you know, podcast.
Yeah.
We're two huge fans of the Cavs. So that's where it's affected me. It was funny. I had tweeted out something early in the game against the Bulls where I go, man, they need to get it together. Chris Theodore, Cleveland.com, hit me back and was like, you sound like a guy who has some money on this game. It's like, you damn straight
you know?
I do. Right? And they need to get money. Like, come on.
And
like,
then Donovan's got to start scoring.
Right. Right. So it's fun. Remember, though, as we talk about gambling, be responsible. That's the biggest thing. That's
1-800-GAMBLER if you have a problem.
For sure. That. Like, if you – listen, if you can't lose it, don't use it. That's been
talk
my way.
Them.
Like, look, if – if I got $20 in this world, I'm not putting it on anybody, right?
Putting down like $2?
Yeah, I'm not betting on anybody at all. So be responsible. If you can't lose it, don't use it. And it's obviously, you know, just to have a little bit of fun. And we've been having a lot of fun in the short term here. Before we kind of get in, I want to go through the power rankings. You got some a Kevin Love take for us?
Yeah, I have a question for you more than anything.
All right.
Are you sure Kevin Love has been a solid rotation player in the NBA this year?
He has not been consistent scoring this year. I would say that. So a solid rotational player, I mean, I guess I would say no.
When you say that he hasn't been consistent scoring, we know that the defense has never been there with Kevin Love. We've never looked at Kevin Love and said, man, you're going to put him on the floor and he's going to get you stops. And he's older in age now.
Mm-hmm.
So when you get older in age, the energy goes away. You're not as quick as you once were. You become a worse defender by default. We've seen it with LeBron over the past couple of years, right? He was a great defender at one point. Is he still? I don't really know.
I think LeBron takes the defensive side
off. Yeah, but I'm saying when you get up there in age, it's just harder to move around and be effective on the defensive end. So you have that going for you. I have some stats for you, Emmett. You know, ESPN stats and info.
Over here. All right, Jake Trotter.
Shout out to Jake Trotter.
Yeah, shout out to Jake.
Kevin Love this year, averaging 9 points a game, 7 rebounds,
mm-hmm.
2 assists, shooting 40% from the field. Rewind that to the previous season where it was the revelation, right?
Right.
Kevin Love, kind of a rebirth, if you will. He was talked about as a legit candidate for the Sixth Man of the Year award throughout majority of the season. Basically, so he's playing 21 minutes a game this year. Was playing 22 minutes a game last year. So basically, he's been on the floor the same amount as he was last year. Last year, he was averaging 14 points a game, 7.5 rebounds, and 2.2 assists on 44% shooting. So every single statistical category is down.
Right.
And the scoring is down a whole 4 points a game.
Mm-hmm.
And I was at the game last night against the Suns, and it's you know, it's a lot easier to see when you're there because, you know, I was sitting up high, too, and you have just a great view of the court. I just noticed on almost every single defensive possession, he was either not in the right spot or the effort wasn't there.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you can look to the numbers and say, well, what about like the charges? He draws a lot of charges, right? And that's good and that's great.
Right.
But and then you can also look at it and say, hey, the Cavs are still arguably the best defensive team in the NBA. So does it really matter? I don't know. But I do know that I've just been a little bit disappointed.
I know that that's loose.
Yeah, I was gonna say, is my chair about to break in the middle?
You're just a very strong guy.
Like,
right, my man's passionate about these Kevin Love takes.
Is Kevin Love a solid rotational player? The take was so strong. What is he talking about? But I just had that thought recently, Emmett, and I tweeted out last night during the game. It's like, when was the last time Kevin Love really had a good game? You know, I feel like for whatever reason, over the last couple games, I've watched him airball a lot of threes. For some reason, I don't know what it is. If it's his legs aren't underneath him, I don't know what it is with Kevin Love, but he just hasn't been the same player that he was last year. And we know how important he was to this team last year. And I wonder if this opens up the possibility of a trade, right? When you look at, you know, because the reason being, Emmett, what's really valuable in the NBA outside of talent? Contracts, right? Kevin Love is on the last year of his contract.
I've been saying this since the start of the season.
You look to last year, right? He was the leader of this team. Is he the leader of this team this year? We just got done talking about how Donovan Mitchell is, right?
I think he's a leader.
I think he's the leader. Yeah. And I think that's different. You know, that makes a difference when you're talking about, do we need to keep this guy around or can we get a better player in here?
Yeah.
I don't know. I've just been a little bit disappointed with him from a number standpoint this year because, like I said, he's been on the court the same amount of time, but he's been significantly less effective than he has than he was last year. He just got done with a stretch of basketball where he failed to score double-digit points. He's only scored double-digit points in three of the last, like, 12 games.
Right.
And a lot of those are mixed in a 9-point game, a 3-point game, a 9-point game, a 6-point game, with some poor shooting sprinkled in there as well. And like I said, the defense has never been there. So I don't know. It's been tough. I've just had that thought recently of, like, is the honeymoon phase from, like, last year and that revelation over? Because I need to see some more production. And I know people, you know, you can tweet at me, at J_Climac20 if you don't agree with me. But really look at the numbers and ask yourself, if I watch Cavs basketball, do I see him making a significant impact on the game night in, night out? And then I know you can say, well, who does make a consistent – well, I watched Kevin Love make a consistent impact on games for 7 years here. Haven't seen it this year.
At the start of the season, me understanding that the trade for Donovan Mitchell depleted the assets that the Cavaliers have, I've been saying they need a three. And I've always said you might have to put Kevin Love in there. At the beginning of the season, that was met with some resistance from Cavs fans. Like, no, Kevin's been so good and you need him. And I'm like, Kevin's been great. But you don't have assets. The assets you have are Kevin Love's expiring contract. You have Caris LeVert, who I think his contract is coming up. And then you have Jetty. Like, those are the only pieces that you can trade because you don't have any picks, really. Not first-rounders, for sure, over the next few years. So those are the only assets that you have. And I was always – I don't care if he was balling right now. If they could find a three, because I think they desperately need that. With Dean Wade being out, and I think Dean Wade would be a great rotational player.
I think
player.
He's getting closer. You know, we've seen him on practice floor and all that.
I feel like Rubio's going to come back before Dean Wade is.
And he should. I mean, where is Rubio, by the way?
He should be here soon, but I've always been for that, just understanding how it works. He is it's a huge number, so you can get a good player in return, and a lot of teams, they're trying to tank. They want to get rid of salary cap. They'll probably want some picks somehow, and, you know, maybe you pair a bunch of seconds or something. I don't know. That's for Kobe Altman and Mike Gansey to figure out. But, yeah, I'm with you, and I still think Kevin has some good nights left in him. But, yeah, I've always been up for the Cavaliers using Love as an asset if they needed to. Let's take a quick look at the weekly power rankings on ESPN as we like to go through from time to time. Where do you think the Cavaliers are if you haven't seen it
yet? I have not seen it yet, so this is going to be a straight guess. And I would say the Cavs are sixth in NBA power rankings.
Okay, well, number one is the Boston Celtics. Okay. We get it.
Got blown out by the Oklahoma City Thunder without Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, but that's a conversation for another time.
Talk about gambling. That wasn't a good night for your boy.
No, it was not a good night for me either.
Number two, the Brooklyn Nets. They have been rolling. I understand why they are at number two.
Tough loss to the Bulls last night, and I was not happy about that one.
It's cold in these
cold
out here streets.
Yeah,
Nuggets at three. Get that. They're 24 and 13.
They've been the best team in the West this year. Yeah. And that's, I think, why they come in at three.
Yeah. Memphis Grizzlies, number four.
Been playing really well recently as well.
Bucks dropped a little bit. They were three last week. They're number five this week. And number six, the Cleveland Cavaliers. Look at Jordan hitting it right on the money. And essentially, Dave McManaman wrote and he told Mitchell, take a bow. Because what he did with the 71 points is amazing. So it's a game we like to play on here and on the next level. Too low, too high, just right.
I think just right.
Okay.
You know, I don't think I would put the Cavs at the top of the Eastern Conference yet. I honestly think the way I've seen them playing, we saw the Nets firsthand, what was it, last week here in Cleveland, and they've just hit a stride, right? They found something with T.J. Warren, who came back. Of course, he was like, you know, that bubble MVP a couple of years ago, and he hasn't really played since then.
Claxton's been playing really well, too.
They found and they needed him because they needed size. They needed someone down low that they could rely on to be a rim protector, and he's been that guy. Kyrie, all of a sudden is actually playing and, like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's amazing what you can do when you just play basketball,
It's funny to say, but, like, yeah, no, he actually has been playing. And then, of course, KD is KD. And I think they found something with Jacque Vaughn as their coach. So the Nets have hit that stride. I'm looking at them as kind of that top spot in the East right now. Bucks are who they are. And I don't think you can argue with, you know, the Nuggets and the Grizzlies, who are both playing crazy basketball right now. Jokic is just doing Jokic things. Ja is doing Ja things. And the Grizzlies haven't really had Jaren Jackson this year.
Right.
And so he's a key piece as well, and they're getting it done without him. So I can't really argue where the Cavs are at in this power rankings now, but, hey, it gives them motivation to keep climbing that ladder.
Yeah, I think it's just right, too. I understand why the teams that are ahead of them are ahead of them, but they're in the mix. Look, top 10 team in the NBA, I think everybody would agree on that, somewhere in the middle right now with an opportunity to rise. So I'm excited about that. All right, we end every
– hold on.
Oh,
I got it. We got to touch on Cavs Suns real quick.
Okay,
I'm making Emmett pause real quick.
Okay.
I thought last night's win for the Cavs might have been the most impressive win of the entire season.
Okay.
And – the reason being, it was one of the worst offensive performances I've seen
in the first half.
And you could probably say that for either team, right? Cavs or Suns.
It was 15-14 after the first quarter.
And when the Cavs, I don't think they scored a point until like 5 or 6 minutes into that game. It was a bad offensive performance. They had no business winning that game against the Suns team, who's been, you know, the best team in the West over the past couple years from a record standpoint. Went to the finals a couple years ago. Obviously, they didn't have Devin Booker last night. But for them to have no business being in that game and somehow pulled out at the end, Emmett, they won that game 90-88. And there were just a lot of things I'd like to see. Evan Mobley didn't have a shot going. There was a lot of things I was disappointed with him from an offensive standpoint last night. But when the game was on the line,
he hit
the game-winning shot.
Yeah.
Raul Neto, a guy that we haven't talked about on this podcast at any point this season.
Right.
The Cavs were in that game and had a chance to win that game in the fourth quarter because of the energy, the defense, and the stretch of basketball that he played at the end of the third quarter. He was getting steals. He was making things happen. He was making life hell for Chris Paul. So the Cavs, to me, like, that's how you know you've arrived as a team. When you have no business winning a game like that, you should have lost that game, but you were able to scrap it out and find a way to win that game. And to me, that just speaks to this team of how good they are. They've arrived. Darius Garland was not there. Darius Garland did not play in that game. Cavs found a way to get the job done in the night where they had their worst offensive performance of the season. And I think that it was the most impressive win of the season for that reason. Nothing went their way the entire night, but they still got the win.
They still got the win, and that's the most important thing on the night. You expect a letdown if you're everybody but me on DraftKings. You expect kind of a letdown. It was, but like you said, they were able to finish and, you know, and bring home the win 90-88. They didn't cover. They were 5-point favorites on DraftKings Sportsbook, but they won, and that is the most important thing. So is Neto going to be in your top three this week?
He might have to be. I mean, it's funny. Like, he's kind of been that guy all year.
Let me stop you.
Yeah, go ahead.
He's not on mine. Chris Paul ate him up, too. All right. Yeah, Chris Paul was getting busy against Neto.
He should.
Right.
Right? You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's true.
It's like, of course he did. It's Chris Paul. It's a Hall of Famer going up against a guy.
Chris was having his way with my man.
It's a game. Right. Like, I just really think, like, in those nights where nobody has it going, right? I didn't expect Mitchell to do much. He wasn't going to have his legs underneath him. He played over 50 minutes in that 71-point performance. And it was such an emotional game for the Cavs, too, that I was going in this game not really expecting them to win that game for that reason. I didn't think the energy was going to be there because there was so much taken out of them in that overtime 71-point performance by Donovan Mitchell. So you had to turn to someone and be like, who is that guy? Who's going to be the spark tonight, right?
We found the loose part, too. I mean,
table doesn't like my Raul Neto take either. But that's
I noticed you hit the table a lot when you make takes.
Raul Neto, man. Put some respect on his name. But no, Emmett, that you have to – someone had to step up last night. Someone had to bring that energy to the Cavs for them to have a chance to win that game. Who knew it was going to be Raul Neto?
Right.
I certainly didn't. You didn't. Rob Lorenzo probably didn't think it was going to be Raul Neto, but it was. And that speaks to J.B. Bickerstaff and this team that, hey, night in, night out, we don't know who it's going to be, mm-hmm. but someone's going to step up and give us a chance to win that game. Somehow, some way, it was Raul Neto last night against the Suns.
Yeah, he did bring the energy. I think about a steal that he had on an inbound.
Scoring at one point
yeah.
in that game.
Yeah, so he definitely gave the energy. I'll start by giving my top three, and I'll start at the top. It has to be Donovan Mitchell at number
one. You don't say.
Yeah, it has to be Donovan Mitchell at the top. Two is a little tough because I think LeVert had a really good game against the Suns, yeah. but he was not good against Chicago. You know what? I know who my two is. My two is Jetty Osman okay. for this week. Double-digit points in the two games so far this week. Jetty's been pretty consistent when he's not on the bench, you know, yeah. for yeah. defensive reasons and stuff like that. So I'll put Jetty number two. And number three, man, I'm going to go J.A. I know, you know, the game against the Suns didn't have a ton of points, only took three shots. But against the Bulls, he did have 21 and 8. So I'm going to go with Spider, Jetty, and J.A. as my top three for this week. Whose are yours?
So agree with you at one.
No. I think that's – I don't know if I said it right. But anyway, give us your top
yes.
three. Right.
Donovan Mitchell coming in at one. Shocker, I know, yes. right? 71-point performance speaks for itself, franchise record, and everything that represents. At two, I'm also going to go with J.A. I don't know if you said J.A. at two or three.
I said him at three.
Okay, so J.A. is going to come in at two for me. I'm just going to go back to what he did against the Bulls. And, you know, he didn't have it going against the Suns last night, but I think he played a key role down low. I think he, you know, mm-hmm. at times DeAndre Ayton got the best of him. At times he got the best of DeAndre Ayton. It was a fascinating matchup to watch down low. But I think he provided that down low presence for the Cavs that they needed last night to, you know, hold the Suns to 88 points and end up getting that win when neither team scored 100. So, J.A. will come in at two for me. At three, I am going to go with Raul Neto, man.
Okay.
We're sticking
yeah, you're way in too deep on the Neto. You got to put him at three this week.
Yeah, I have to. Like, it's just I have to. I mean, you go to the game against the Bulls, he didn't really do anything, right? I mean, 17 minutes, 4 points, 2 assists, right? Didn't do anything in that game. But then, you know, you fast forward to the Suns game. Like I said, who is going to be the person to bring the energy? Who is going to be the spark on a night where the Cavs are coming off of such an emotional performance? And lo and behold, it was Raul Neto. 21 minutes in that game, 14 points, 2 rebounds, didn't have an assist. But the defense, the steal at the end, right? Like, I think, you know, that play that he made to get that steal off the quick inbounds and the quick mm-hmm. basket. To me, those one of those baskets in the NBA that is only worth 2 points, but it counted for like six. And what I mean by that is it got the crowd back into the game.
Because the crowd was
quiet.
The crowd
was not in the game. I was at the game. The crowd was, you know, the whole time we're sitting there, I'm talking to random people. Ah, this is, what are we watching?
Yeah, right.
I mean? That's kind of the night it was. And then he kind of flipped the switch in that third quarter, and a crowd got involved. Then all of a sudden, the team had energy for the fourth. So I think he's largely responsible for the reason that the Cavs were able to defeat the Phoenix Suns. So he'll come in at three for me, Raul Neto. Mm-hmm. Crazy, you know, I'm gonna feel like we're gonna watch this. I'm gonna watch
this
episode and
like this is
I randomly
wild.
Picked Raul Neto as the top three Cavs at one point earlier in the year, but hey, it is what it is. He got the job done. Raul Neto at three, Jared Allen at two, and of course, Spider Mitchell.
All right, that is our top three for the week. Again, you can catch us every Thursday now that the holidays are over. I understand
we're back.
Rebound
we're back.
Fans are a rambunctious bunch. We will have you every Thursday. We record. We post it shortly thereafter. So we appreciate everybody watching. Shout out to Audi Middleburg Heights. Check them out. And we will catch you on the rebound.
Let them know.